We have a fantastic panel. We're going to discuss what's at stake in the oceans. We're going to talk about some of the problems in the ocean, some potential solutions. Ideally, we'll end, we'll walk out of this room 45 minutes from now, all smarter, and also with an action plan. So, fabulous panel, starting with Prince Albert, head of state in Monaco. We have Bill Hilf, the CEO of Vulcan. We have Kerstin Forsberg, he is the founder and director of Planet Oceana. And we have Enric Sala, who has the slightly contradictory title of Explorer in Residence at the National Geographic Society. And so we're going to begin. Enric is going to start. He's going to do an 8.5-minute presentation. We're going to learn a lot, and then we're going to kick off a conversation, talk for another 25 minutes, and then we'll open it up for questions. So, Enric, let's go.
Thank you so much. Monseigneur, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, the ocean, the largest feature on our planet. It is so vast that once it was thought inexhaustible, it was thought too big to fail. After World War II, industrial fishing targeted mostly the shores of the Northern Hemisphere. In this map, you can see the higher footprint of fishing in red going to lower footprint in white. As time went by and fish stocks were depleted near shore, fishing moved offshore and deeper. And today, over half of the planet is targeted by industrial fishing, and we're fishing all the way down to 3,000 meters, far deeper than what sunlight can reach. Because of that, 90% of the large fish in the ocean, sharks, billfish, tuna, have been removed by fishing since 1950. Some species of sharks have lost 99% of their numbers, and that happened in less than a century. As a consequence, global fishing catch has been declining since the mid-90s. We reached peak fish 24 years ago, and about two-thirds of the fish stocks today are experiencing overfishing. So what's the solution? Well, before that, in many places, fishermen are not catching much fish anymore. Their nets are filled with gelatinous masses. What used to be clear waters full of large vertebrates are now murky dystopias full of jellyfish. So what's the solution? If we want more marine life in the ocean, we need to fish less. But fishing less is not good enough. We also need to give the ocean space so marine life can bounce back and replenish the ocean once again. And for that, there is nothing better than marine protected areas. Areas where fishing and other extractive activities are prohibited, the equivalent of national parks in the sea. And I'd like to show you what happens when we protect an ocean area. A little place called Cabo Pulmo in Mexico in the mid-90s was an underwater desert. The fishermen were so upset with not having enough fish to catch that they decided to fish completely. When we returned 10 years after, everything had changed. We had seen it, we saw it come back to pristine in only 10 years, including the return of the large predators like the groupers, the sharks, and the jacks. And those visionary fishermen are now making far more money from diving tourism inside the reserve and better fishing around. And we have seen this miracle happen all over the world. On average, the biomass of fish inside fully protected areas is 6 times greater than in fished areas nearby. And because the fish inside these parks are larger, they produce a disproportionately larger number of eggs, which helps to replenish the fishing areas around. So if protected areas are so beneficial to people, to marine life, and to the local economies, how much of the ocean have we protected? Today, only 7% of the ocean is in areas that have been designated or proposed as protected. But less than 3% of the ocean is fully protected. So how much more do we need to protect? The science is very clear. We need at least 30% of the ocean fully protected by 2030 if we are to prevent the extinction of species and the collapse of our life support system, and if we are to achieve the goals of the Paris Climate Agreement. But some will say that marine protected areas are not going to address the other whale in the room, global warming. The ocean has absorbed 90% of the extra heat generated by human activities. And 2019 was the year where we recorded the hottest temperatures in the ocean. That has killed coral reefs all around the world. When corals are exposed to hot temperatures for too long, they lose the microscopic algae that live in symbiosis within them. Corals get their color from these algae. So when they lose the algae, the corals bleach. And many of these corals will die and stand their skeletons ghostly white, waiting to be overgrown by seaweed and sponges. But marine protected areas cannot make the water cooler. So how can they help? Well, they can make reefs more resilient to the impacts of climate change. In 2015, a massive warming event across the Pacific Ocean killed many corals of Australia. But in the Central Pacific, a few protected areas harboring pristine reefs full of large fish. In these places, corals are coming back. These places are full of fish that keep the reef clean and facilitate the returns of the corals. So baby corals are now growing on top of the corals that bleached and died. So while the solution, the definitive solution for ocean warming is phasing off fossil fuels, fully protected areas can help us buy time. But some will say that we cannot protect more because we have to feed 10 billion people. But our recent research shows that by protecting the right places in the ocean, that more than 30% of the ocean by 2030 would protect key biodiversity, boost fisheries productivity globally, secure carbon stocks, and many other benefits. In this map, the yellow polygons are the areas that are fully protected today, and the light green areas are the top priorities for protection moving forward. These are brand new data. So now no policymaker can say that we don't know where we should focus our efforts. We know that marine life comes back spectacularly when we protect places or when we protect species. Mm-hmm. Humpback whales. In the last couple centuries, they were hunted so intensely that we almost drove them to extinction. But after a whaling moratorium in 1963, their numbers have recovered dramatically. And now we can see spectacles like this once again. But there is more. Whales eat massive amounts of krill and small fish, which contain significant amounts of iron in their tissues. The whale expel much of this iron in their feces when they come to the surface to breathe, fertilizing the shallow waters and fostering the blooms of microscopic algae, whose growth absorbs a lot of carbon from the atmosphere and the water, thus helping to mitigate climate change. And more microscopic algae means more krill and more fish. The ocean has been a victim of man-made climate change, but it can also be a powerful solution. We just need to give the ocean the space it needs to continue providing for us and for the rest of life on our planet. Thank you.
All right, well, let's begin with the one gentleman on the panel who has a gold star, a gold decal on his badge, because he's a head of state. So actually somebody who...
Where's my badge?
It's gone, but it's very cool, I've got to say. I've moderated a lot of panels here in Davos, and you're my first gold decal.
I got that going for me, which is nice.
So somebody who actually has power over regulations, how should we think about how government should regulate the oceans and how protect it, since, as Enric says, the ocean has been a victim?
It has been a victim, and it's been a victim for a long time, and it's time to change that. And we have been trying to do that. I'd say we collectively, all those involved in ocean conservation or ocean-related issues, and to see the connections between oceans and climate, which was finally, it's been established for a long time, but it's been finally made public in a very good report by the IPCC that Monaco and other countries helped promote and help put together, and it was finally presented last September in Monaco, and I think it has helped a lot in not only the awareness and the decision-making process, but I think it's helped with a lot of interesting data. I mean, nothing that was that surprising on the terrible state of our oceans, but and of the cryosphere and of the frozen areas of the world, that they are diminishing and that they that needs to be addressed in the whole climate change package, if you'd like. But I think what, and this is why it's so difficult to try to speak after Enric, because he gives all the, he pushes all the right buttons, of course, and gives all the latest data. And so now with this new data that you've just provided on MPAs, on marine protected areas, I think there absolutely is no reason why policymakers and why governments and heads of government or heads of state cannot put the right policies in place. It's just a question of putting these issues at the top of their agenda, and that's the most difficult thing to do.
So the proper solution is to take Enric's map of the areas that should be protected
and protect them? And send that to every head of state and head of government.
Are there any other heads of state here? Check your neighbor's decals. If they're a head of state, please send them to them.
Or at least ministers that can push this map forward.
Well, let's talk about maps. We have one of the great experts on ocean data here, Bill. One of the things about the ocean is it's hard to understand. It's so vast. It's so huge. But you've collected, you've synthesized, and you've made available some extraordinary data. So can you answer three questions? What is the data you have? What is the data we need? And how are you using artificial intelligence right now to sort through that data? And we'll get a better understanding of what we're learning about the oceans and what we still need to learn.
Okay, I'm going to restructure your three questions. I'm going to answer the second one first. I'm going to go 2, 1, 3. The data that we need, although there's a lot of great data that was presented, we're still massively short of what we need. We're about 80% of the ocean is undocumented, unobserved, unexplored. 80%. And of all the SDGs, number 14, least measured. And it's a big problem. So when we look at what the possibility of enforcement, monitoring, we need more data. We need a lot more data. And so let me get to the first. What we do now is we take mostly satellite-related data, working with different satellite partners, and we bring that into a cloud-based service. And we run a whole bunch of AI over the top to identify patterns. And the more data that we can feed that machine learning, the better it will be at pattern matching and helping us predict what might happen in the future, not just what happened in the past. And that's really our goal, is to get credible and current data so that for policymaking, for regulators, for enforcement, Coast Guards, navies, people actually going out and doing on-sea interdictions, have real-time data to go put the stick behind those paper parks or the lines drawn on a map around an MPA. If you can't enforce it, it's not worth very much.
And the data you're collecting is where the fishing ships are? It's where the wildlife
is? Yeah, it's mostly ships. So it's mostly looking at fishing vessels, taking a pattern of where they've been traveling, how long they've been at sea, do they do transshipments on the open ocean? And we use a variety of different techniques using AIS, electrical optical imagery, synthetic aperture radar, but a bunch of sensors on a satellite. And as satellites have grown over time, we've seen the cost go down and the revisit rates go up so that we can actually see a lot more boats on the ocean. So that if we see a ship that's traveling within an EEZ or within an MPA, we can immediately alert that local enforcement agency to say, you should go investigate that vessel.
And does your data help us understand where we should put new MPAs, or does it just help us track violators of current MPAs?
Good question. Not yet where we should put new MPAs, but this is why we partner with Enrique and the National Geographic team on pristine seas as we sort of map out together. We provide the monitoring enforcement tools behind there.
Okay. So, Kerstin, let's go to the other end of the sort of the spectrum of approaches and let's not talk about satellites and data. Let's talk about communities in Peru. So there's a lot that we talk about in Davos with global policy, but it also, of course, we need to work within cultures, work within norms. Explain your work in protecting the ocean and how it ties into the other folks on the stage.
Sure, thank you. Well, first of all, Thank you to my fellow panelists that are doing an amazing job to protect the ocean. We all depend on the ocean. We could not even be here if there wasn't an ocean. Our life depends on the ocean. When we breathe, we're breathing oxygen that's generated by the ocean. The weather that we have is given to us by the ocean. So for me, when I talk about ocean, I talk about people. And there's no other way to talk about it. We've talked about the urgency. We've talked about the complexity of the challenges. And we need, one, a critical mass to solve that urgency of people on the ground. And two, we need different approaches. Not one single approach will solve the issues that our oceans have. So kind of going into the work that I do, I run a nonprofit called Planeta Oceano that I began many years ago when I was 22 years old as a young environmentalist. And basically what we do is we engage people in marine conservation through a multidisciplinary approach. We're working with communities on the research side, collecting data that can lead to management. We're engaging education with schools, and we're working with coastal community development, incubating local projects that can lead to sustainable development. So really my work in terms of communities and what I've learned is that people have a chance to contribute to everything. Citizens, we're working with fishermen that are also collecting data, and we have one of our flagship projects on giant manta rays, for example, that we were talking about earlier. And it was through fishermen that we were able to understand the population of giant manta rays and then work with the government to legally protect the giant manta rays. It was through working with schools that we were able to work with students and kids, and we had girls report the very first evidence of green turtle nesting in the country that can then lead to management for that population. So really we have all these people on the ground. We have like an army of people on the ground that I think the ocean community isn't taking advantage of or leveraging support enough in order to work towards these issues. So what I would say to move forward the agenda, we need to have more local leaders on the ground. We need to invest in them. We need to develop multiplier effects. If you invest in one leader, that leader can go out to the community and then develop a whole multiplier effect with their friends, with their families, and so forth.
So do any of the fishermen you work with feel weirded out by Bill's satellite trackers tracking all the boats?
I mean, I think, I think, like I said, all of the solutions have to come together. We're going out with fishermen and we're putting satellite tags on giant manta rays to track their migration. And we're starting to analyze, you know, migration of hammerhead sharks. And so it's not one or the other, but it's everything that has to come together. And if we don't start developing dialogue and building those connections between the communities, the policymakers, the scientists, the schools, if we don't start bridging that gap, we won't get to what we want to achieve.
Yeah, Enric, I enjoyed your map of all the places we should protect, all those circles, but I was watching you on YouTube a couple of days ago, and you didn't say just protect this area and that area and this area is green. You said protect the entire high seas and kick everybody off the high seas. So which is it?
This map, is it? Okay, now the high seas. So there are two oceans when it comes to management. The 200 miles exclusive economic zones that belong to individual countries and individual countries manage and are responsible for. And then the waters beyond national jurisdiction, which we call the high seas. The EEZs, the exclusive economic zones, are 40% of the ocean. The high seas, 60% of the ocean. Most of the fish comes from the EEZs, 96% of it, actually. Only 4% of the fish come from the high seas. Right? However, the high seas is a place where there are lots of activities that put in jeopardy the viability of high-value species commercially, like sharks and tuna. But also there is a place where violations of human rights occur. And we conducted an economic analysis a couple of years ago that showed that half of the fishing in the high seas would not be profitable without government subsidies and slave labor. This is why I said in that TED talk that if we protected all of the high seas to fishing, that would be the economically and humanitarily most optimal thing to do. Now, if we want to preserve key biodiversity that is unique and irreplaceable, that provides most services to humanity. This is within the 200 miles exclusive economic zones. And let's not be mistaken about that. 96% of the problem is occurring within those 200 miles. This is why most of the protected areas moving forward should be placed within countries' jurisdictions.
Very interesting. Okay, I have a sort of a general question for the panel that I was thinking of while you were saying that, which is that as you protect oceans and as you protect water, there's a question between quantity and quality. Presumably you can severely protect a small number of areas and strictly enforce it, or you can lightly protect large numbers. How do you think about that balance? I would ask anybody. Prince Albert?
Well, just to go back on the BBNJs, what we call the beyond national jurisdictions, the negotiations are still going on at the UN and will be resuming, I think, next spring. And these negotiations have been on for quite a while, quite a number of years now. But there is still hope that they will be able to be protected. I don't know to what extent. And of course, we all hope that they're fully protected. But there's a hope that there will be, at the end of these negotiations, a draft that will be presented to the General Assembly, hopefully by the end of the year. So we have to keep our fingers crossed. But I think, generally, I think, depending, and probably Enric could address this more, but we as he said, we need as many fully protected MPAs as possible, be they in coastal areas, be they around, be they in remote areas, or be they on the high seas. The faster people and policymakers will be able to understand that, the better we will be able to set up funds like we have for the Mediterranean. There's a Mediterranean Trust Fund for MPAs in the Mediterranean, and that can, I think that model can be reproduced in other parts of the world. So the funding of marine protected areas is absolutely crucial, but also their enforcement, the enforcement of the surveillance of these MPAs. But of course, if you have the funds, then you have the personnel and the equipment and the technology to better protect them.
And also just building on in marine protected areas, of course we need these marine protected areas, but it doesn't mean that we want to exclude the other parts of the ocean, right? We need better fisheries management, better management in general for like our oceans, for our species, for our biodiversity. We need to start thinking about marine protected areas and connectivity between the marine protected areas as well. There are corridors that have migratory species that are passing from one to the other. So I think that we really do need these this 30% by 2030, but we need to start thinking about what framework we're going to give to our planet in general. So it's not just like a bit or a lot. It's really thinking about all of it.
Enric? May I add something to what Monsignor said? The funding is very important, right? But, the money is there. The two main drivers of loss of marine life right now are extraction of biomass by fishing and global warming. The world subsidizes, government subsidizes fishing with $35 billion per year, mostly to destructive fishing practices. And we subsidize fossil fuel companies with $300 billion per year pre-tax. And then society has to pay an extra $5 trillion for the cost of burning fossil fuels. So we're talking about more than $5 trillion that are used to subsidize the practices that destroy biodiversity. The money is there, right? We're just using it for the wrong things.
You should redirect the money to Bill's data analysis. We'd actually get all the data that we need on how to monitor the oceans. Explain. What is your preferred policy preference for what we do with the oceans? If you could leave this room, everybody agreeing on one thing that's going to happen, what would it be?
To tie into your last question, there's a wide variety of states of maturity per country when it comes to their ability to monitor and enforce. Some at a very low level of capability, some that are well developed and very sophisticated. So when we look at where then you take that and lay over a map of the most sensitive zones, the most sensitive areas that we have, you'll find a lot of these areas are right on the shores of countries that don't have a lot of capability. To answer your follow-on question, I would want us to first say, how can we superpower and supercharge those countries in the most need to give them those abilities that the developed countries have today, so they can monitor and enforce and at least start to get a baseline.
Yeah.
That would move the needle. We'd start seeing double-digit percentages start to move the right way. The U.S. doesn't need this help.
Right.
This is not who we're talking about. It's,
how's Monaco doing?
Monaco's doing just fine. What do you think I'm going to say next to him on the panel? But you take a country like Palau. Palau has one or two cutters to go do interdictions. So can we help them be a lot more effective in where they send that ship? That's success in my mind.
Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. All right, we're going to move to audience Q&A, but before we do that, I want to show some data. We have some unique data that hasn't been seen before, and it shows the effective sea level rise. So what I'm going to try to do is to stun you into terror, and then we'll move to audience Q&A. So let's let's take a look at this data. Illah, do you want to explain what we're looking at?
To the future. So right now we're looking at projected rise after a 2-degree warming world, which as we know is towards the lower end of what we might expect right now.
I'm going to have to swim to work. All right, let's go to audience Q&A. Please raise your hand and identify yourself and ask our fabulous panelists whatever you'd like to ask them. Yes, right here in the third row.
So two related questions. One is, what is the role of recreational fishing as opposed to commercial fishing? As an avid fly fisherman, I'm wondering what I can do. And secondly, how do you think about in your protection spawning grounds as a priority or not?
So when you look at the fishing globally, commercial fishing, industrial fishing is much, much, much bigger than recreational fishing, right? In some places like the Gulf of Mexico, some species are caught more by recreational fishermen than by global fishermen. So it's a local issue, but globally it's industrial fishing, which receives all of the subsidies that is the biggest extractor of biomass. However, in some places, recreational fishing, well managed and high end, can actually help protect some places. There is a place, the Jardines de la Reina, the Gardens of the Queen in southern Cuba, that is a diving paradise. It looks like the underwater, like the Caribbean that Columbus would have seen if he dived 500 years ago. And they allow a small commercial operation of catch and release for tarpon, permit, barracuda. And the fishermen, poor fishermen, pay a lot of money to go there. They also help to tag the fish and contribute to research. And that place, the sport fishing pays for the management of the place, actually. So in a few places, if well managed, it can be a solution. It could be better than no protection at all. And spawning of spanning grounds, of course, is a no-brainer. Yeah.
I think I saw Sylvia Earle's hand up. Would you like to ask a question? So,
for deepness.
One of our great ocean explorers.
Fellow explorer in residence. So, Enric, you made a good case for why we have an opportunity without too much burden on the world as a whole for protecting the high seas, basically half of the world. At this time, it's being discussed. Could we, might we actually put a moratorium on industrial extraction of wildlife from the high seas? What penalty would that impose on the world? And what benefit would we receive? And at the same time, right at this moment, deep sea mining is being put forward as something that could dramatically alter the nature of the deep sea in the high seas. So I guess a question, could, especially to you, but really to all, at this critical moment in time, if we really want to be taking bold steps to address the carbon cycle, carbon capture, planetary stability, why shouldn't we be going all out to protect the high seas and the deep sea while there is time to do so before vested interests get further embedded? When you look at technologies that are make a case for mining the deep sea, seems like a poor business model to base your industry on a material that is difficult to extract, like unobtainium would be an example. So what would you do? Why can't we, instead of tiptoeing around, oh, we need 30% by 2030, which is really important, why not go for half of the world in one stroke with a moratorium on the most damaging things that are taking place there in the deep sea as well as up there in the sunlit surface waters?
Yes. Thank you. Can I answer the first question?
Yes, please.
You're absolutely right, Sylvia. Protecting all of the high seas from a rational perspective, it would be the easiest place to do, the easiest thing to do, for several reasons. One, only 4% of the fish come from the high seas. Two, those fish are luxury items. We published another paper in Science a couple of years ago showing that the fish from the high seas does not contribute to global food security. Right? These are mostly tuna that go to sashimi in food-secure countries, and sharks that go to shark fin soup mostly in China. Right? Three, we have the issues of human rights violations. So from an economic perspective, from a biological perspective, it's clear that bottom trawling these seamounts and further depleting tuna populations is very, very destructive, so it's a no-brainer. From the economic perspective, also, it makes a lot of sense. So there was another study that showed that if we protected all of the high seas to fishing, that the high seas would become a place where a refuge for all these species that migrate between the high seas and countries' waters. So there would be more tuna for for people to catch within their exclusive economic zones at less cost. And then the number of winners would increase because developing countries that don't have the ability to go to the high seas to catch the tuna and could catch them within their waters. Who will lose? A few countries, mostly five countries, China, Taiwan, Korea, Japan, and Spain, who catch 3/4 of the fish in the high seas. And why cannot we make this happen? Because of the tuna commissions. The high seas is divided in blocks that are managed by tuna commissions that are composed of the countries that fish in those areas. And even though there are studies saying that we need to, the same commissions have scientists that are recommending fishing less so the tuna can recover, the decisions are purely political. So the tuna commissions basically are the main reason why we are not protecting more of the high seas.
And can I quickly add, what worries me a lot is that, and Bill had already mentioned this about the fact that we don't have enough data on our oceans. We don't have enough data on the resources that we have in our oceans. Many cases, the fisheries that we have, we don't even have proper information on the baseline, on the stocks, on what's going on. And so in activities such as, for example, seabed mining, we don't even have maybe sufficient information on those areas, on what can be the impact, not only to the ocean, but to ourselves. We're talking about a major risk for our planet, for humankind. So I think that in general, we need to be very cautious and take a precautionary approach in any sort of activity or economic activity that we're doing and understand the data before we do any sort of management.
So we have four people with very different backgrounds, very different lines of work. But if I'm reading it correctly, it sounds like all four of you would be in favor of banning fishing on the high seas, 50% marine protected areas within the 200 miles of the coastline, and a ban on deep sea mining. Those are three very bold stances, and yet we have unanimity here?
Yes.
I'd agree with that. Can I add to Sylvia's question? what Sylvia's saying, what she's saying is, at least how I heard it is, you have a chance here for preventative health care versus an ambulance. A lot of these other projects that we're talking about are ambulances.
Exactly.
Like, you know, going and getting these boats as they drive the trawler right through. Those are ambulances. So what she's saying is, hey, go fight the fight, because you have a chance to actually take your cholesterol medication and not have the heart attack, you know? So I'm with you.
All right. Well, okay. Does anybody disagree? Would anybody say that perhaps on one of those issues we're going a little bit too far and respect the rights of the high seas tuna fishermen and the industrial extractors? No. And the, no?
Luckily, the deep sea mining session is happening at the same time.
Oh, no, I had that one this morning. We got in, Sylvia was quite eloquent. And
You know what you were doing? When you put things in perspective, it's like we're trying to make as much money as possible in the casino of the Titanic after hitting the iceberg.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good image.
So you have to be extreme.
All right. Next question from the audience, please. Yes, in the back. Anne.
Well, so there's unanimity in the room because we're all self-selected. So what we need to do is reach the people who are outside the room, who maybe have a different point of view but are perhaps persuadable. What are the best ways to tackle that, particularly at a conference where we're talking about sustainable development goals and the investment of capital around the world and how capital is distributed, which has to have a major impact on what will happen to the ocean?
Hmm. Well, it's... You really want me to go ahead?
I do. that is a question that deserves an answer.
But I think everybody can contribute, and I'm sure Sylvia can also jump in at any time. Well, I think it's all about the whole issue about getting the message out there. We were talking about that with several people before the session, and of course there are various ways of doing that. And of course, it's engaging not only the corporate world, but also governments and policymakers, as I said before. But just civil society as a whole. There's still a lot of people in different countries that don't know what the SDGs are. So we have to start with that too, and to make that and there are different. They've also made that change the image of the SDGs to make them understandable by 5-year-old kids, and so we should be able to convince adults to not only to understand them and to get to know them, but to try to help because everybody at any level and at every level of society can play their part, not only in ocean conservation, but in other environmental issues as well. And so it's really still frustrating to see how we can't get the word out there in a more significant way. So that's why we need all of you.
Well, Kerstin, let's have you take a crack at the same answer. So when you're in Peru and you're talking to a big fisherman and you're trying to persuade them of your policy position, how does it go?
Sure. So I would say, first of all, it's not easy. And I think we all need to understand and embrace that. But second, I think that what we need to do is promote more dialogue. And that's the work that we do is all around promoting dialogue and listening, and like genuinely listening to each other. So I work with small-scale fishermen. Have connections with industrial fishermen as well, but our main work is with small-scale fishermen. And the work that we have done so far is basically sitting down at the same table. So I think that we need more of those spaces. Sitting down at the same table and talking about what are the issues. Mm-hmm. And in case of the small-scale fishermen, we understand what issues they are going through, and we try to build solutions together with them. And I think that is where the true ownership really comes. And if we want to scale marine conservation and protection globally, we need true ownership by everybody. And so in this case, when we work, for example, with a fisherman and we were able to get the legislation proposal out for the giant manta rays, it was really sitting down with them, them understanding what were the benefits or not benefits of getting the manta protection in place, and then driving the solution from the very beginning. So it's not... one thing that I've always kind of critiqued in terms of participatory projects. A true participatory project is something that starts with everybody's having their ideas together from the very beginning, from the ideation phase. It's not like doing like a conservation project in which you're bringing in a fisherman while you're implementing at some stage later. It's bringing people in from the very beginning. So if you start with those spaces and you nurture those dialogues, if you just, you know, take your time, we've been able to get positive solutions. I don't think it's going to be easy because, you know, underwater seabed miners, I think it's another realm. But I do think that we need more spaces in which we can bring together. I think that the ocean community for a long time and ocean scientists, we've been kind of like in our own silos. You know, we're like what you were saying, we're self-selecting ourselves. We need to start thinking about other people. And I see it with the fishermen as well that we work with. I can't go up to them. Just before I came here, we went out to field, and the fishermen were bringing in these tiny tuna. But if you go and you tell the fishermen, you know, don't fish, what else are they going to... Like, they need alternatives. They need to feed their kids. So we also have to put ourselves in their shoes. And how are we going to... And that's where maybe social projects can come through that. So we need to start talking with people in charge of social projects beyond the ocean community. So I think it's about being creative and nurturing that dialogue.
But what did you specifically say to the fisherman with the tiny tuna?
So in that case, and then that's the other thing, it's long term. We can't think about solutions being short term. So if I would go to them and say like, hey, you know, you're awful, like, why are you doing this? They're not going to listen to me. They're not going to open their doors to me. And then we're not going to be able to work together in the long term. So basically what happened there was a conversation of where they were finding that tuna, because that's another thing. I want to learn from them. I want to understand where they're finding that tuna, where they found the tuna, when they're getting it, how much comes out. And then you can explain a bit about the tuna, and then you can get another meeting another day and sit down and then just start developing that relationship in the long term that can build solutions.
All right, well, we have, let's get one quick question in the back, and then we'll do wrapping up.
One question is respect to, the consensus in the room here about deep sea mining, and I'm very new to the subject. I hear it here on the forum for the first time. Given that we equally would say we are very much pro-electrification and getting CO2 out of the air, what alternatives do you see to where we get cobalt from? Because I hear from many other discussions, so-called cobalt, centrally in Congo, dependent on China. One structural alternative is deep sea mining. As we are all in full agreement to both targets, do you and the panel have any clue, or let's say a clue? Can you give us a clue how you see alternatives to that?
Well, I'm not an expert in deep sea mining or cobalt, but there is an analysis that shows that not only cobalt but other minerals, there is a lot of waste. It's very inefficient use. So recycling much of what we have today would solve much of the problem in the jungles of West Africa.
Anybody else have expertise in deep sea mining who wants to answer this?
Not really. I mean, I don't really have an expertise.
Me neither. But I think that's where like the technology and the innovation and the science needs to come in. So that's where it needs to come in.
We're 8 years away from deep sea mining or so. So somebody please invent a lithium iron battery that doesn't cobalt. All right. So wrap it up. We have 30 seconds left. Just say quickly what you hope happens in the next 3 years with the oceans, with ocean preservation.
So in October this year, at the COP15 of the Convention on Biodiversity in Kunming, China, the countries of the world agreed to protect at least 30% of the ocean and the land by 2030. And in 3 years, we have started implementing it.
Okay. Kerstin?
So for me, it's ownership in terms of ocean issues in all sectors across society, and really scaling up ocean literacy, and especially in everybody, really understanding what the ocean means to us and having people really act in small or big ways towards the ocean.
Bill? The biggest blocker I see into the problem I described earlier around closing that data gap, understanding is not so, we have the technology, we have all the tech today. It's talent. It's getting the young, bright woman who's graduating with a computer science degree to go work in this field versus micro-targeting ads for a social network platform, just as an example. And that's an economic problem. It's not a mission problem. It's an economic problem. So in 3 years, I'd like us to see, as a community, how do we tip that scale so we can get the best and brightest working on the most important problems and not just being slurped up by the technology or financial industries.
I also would like to see more MPAs, and I hope that that will happen in Kunming at the Convention on Biodiversity. But I also think, and we didn't really have time to talk about that, but to move forward on promoting the blue economy, yeah, and offshore renewable energies. I think that's absolutely vital for our future, not only because it's the right thing to do, and it's one of the directions that we have to take, but because it's a real economic opportunity, and it will create many, many jobs.
All right, thank you for a fabulous panel, and at whatever fancy dinner you go to tonight, if they have shark fin soup on the menu, please have a look at the host. Thank you very much.